Good morning, everyone. We deeply appreciate you selecting our session amidst the array of impressive presentations happening concurrently in other tracks. And today we'll delve into the pivotal role that SDR plays in the realm of military drones. Let's now turn to my colleague, David, who will lead us further in this topic.
So we are Gabriela Garcia and David Melendez. In that case, Gabriela, aka Gabs, is the first time in DEF CON for her. And she's a security developer and a hacker and a hacking communities organizer. She's also coding and cyber security instructor and mentor. And she's helping me to present this presentation because my English is from Zaragoza, Spain. So she's attending several conferences like Codemotion, GS Day in Canarias. It's a good place to go to the beach. And in my case, it's not my first time in at DEF CON. But it's like this with Shoot the Noob. I still processing the Jack Daniels, maybe. So it's not my first time in DEF CON, also in several places, like the most famous conference in Spain, like as RouterCon. And I am a book author about drones, Hacking with Drones. It's a very original name. And just to show how old I am, I am very fan of Campus Party. So, Caps, let's go.
Okay, the context. As some of you may have accidentally heard, we are in a wartime context. There is currently an alarming high number of conflicts occurring around the globe, and military equipment manufacturers emphasize in one primary objective, which is to minimize casualties. This is where drones take on particular significance as instrument of warfare. Next, okay.
Next.
Drones? Sorry?
Yeah, let's go. Yeah.
Drones have evolved into essential instruments of warfare due to various factors. They enable precision strikes in combat, they eliminate the need for onboard personnel, and they are perfectly suited for symmetrical warfare and are crucial in executing tactics and strategies for real-time cover operations. Drones as a precision-guided weapon offer numerous advantages. They ensure greater accuracy in attacks, resulting in reduced collateral damage and fewer civilian casualties. They minimize human risk as they are remotely operated, and their operational duration is extended since there's no concern for fatigue. Additionally, their versatility is showcased by the capability to be equipped by a rank of weaponry from missiles to bombs. In symmetrical warfare, drones offer cost effectiveness when compared to traditional manned aircraft, and this is evident through cost reductions in drone production methods such as cargo drones, wooden drones, 3D printing, and the use of affordable chipsets. In strategic terms, drones offer tools for real-time cover operation and tactics, and additionally, they enhance surveillance capabilities, aiding in data collection and intelligence purposes. Drones also serve as a powerful asset for SIGINT, given their ability to gather information, intercept and analyze enemy communication and electronic signals. They can access challenging regions, operate continuously for extended periods, and transmit data in real time for prompt threat response. Furthermore, they can execute cover missions for high altitudes or using discrete flight patterns. So prevalent anti-drones measure includes utilizing both thermals and standard cameras for shape recognition, detecting heat emissions for engines and electronics, analyzing distinct drone noise characteristics, employing radio frequency and waveform detection, and identifying unique radio signatures. To counteract detection measures, operators employ several strategies like using frequency hopping, engaging jammers that operate on unconventional frequencies, implement robust communication protocols, and so much more. But it's important to highlight that regardless of the advancement, no drone can effectively withstand a direct physical attack, like a gunshot or a stone.
Okay, guys. Thank you. So, I want to talk about this type of drones as war elements. So, we're going to start the use of drones for seeing signals, they are used to collect information, extend reach to hard access areas, prolonged operations, real-time transmissions, as Gabs said, and cover operations for high altitudes and discrete flight patterns. So, The typical anti-drone missiles, they are distributed to thermal and standard cameras for shape detection. So you detect the drones as the shape of the drone. It's like a drone, it must be a drone. So detecting the heat of the electronics, especially the motors. So you see four heat spots in the sky, maybe it's not a pigeon, so it's a drone. So using artificial intelligence or natural intelligence, maybe, so you can detect those drones simply by seeing them, or by sight or by cameras. Another technique is characterization of drone noise. If it sounds like brr, it's a drone, but it's you know. Also, the most typical way to detect a drone is by radio frequency and waveform detection. So we have here the most important way to detect a drone, and the most cheap also, just because most drones works as with Wi-Fi devices, Wi-Fi communications, and if we have a Wi-Fi detector, it's not very expensive, so we have to detect the drones by Wi-Fi characterization. So most of the drones nowadays has the capability to transmit through Wi-Fi or 2.4 gigahertz and 5. So it's very easy to detect a drone with this method. And the last one is radio signature, using SDR devices with the typical waterfall that we're going to see. So in last DEF CON, I talked about this topic, and the topic is the same as the last one. So the counter measures are very is the same. No? Is the frequency hopping and the unexpected frequencies. So typically, police devices, state force devices, tries to jam the signal of the drones with the with jammers using the same fixed frequencies. They are the typical Wi-Fi jammer and the 5 gigahertz jammer, and they are very constrained to that frequencies. And the last one is the most funny, is just shoot the drone, right? It's the best one, but it's the more expensive one. And it's not very, it's not very subtle. I want to explain the evolution of the Atropos. If you play StarCraft 2, as I am, you will not know that as a banshee. Atropos is banshee in Spain, in Spanish. So I am original, right? I know. Yeah. The Atropos is a very, very old drone that I made like a decade ago, more than a decade. I was young, I was in my 20s, just to notice that I'm not still in my 20s. So, well, it's a homemade router, it's a homemade quadcopter with a Wi-Fi router. It's, it was made when the Raspberry Pi didn't exist, luckily, and when the Arduino was starting. So I use a microcontroller from Microchip, the big one, for generate the PWDM signal to the motors, and the stabilization unit is from a Y9 chuck and Motion Plus from Nintendo. So they are glued inside the drone without the case, obviously. Yeah. So I use the web page of the router as a telemetry control. So for control and telemetry of the drone, I've used that method. So the first approach to control the drone was indeed Wi-Fi. So the first attack I suffered in a conference was at the authentication attack long time ago, and so we are here from that. As years passed, I was equipped the drone with several tools like WPS attack with bully inside the with extra onboard hardware and so on. So the first approach with this drone is to avoid the authentication attacks with using beacon frames. That was the first approximation. So just a lateral, just another functionality was to inspect all the frames, all the beacon frames of the environment. So just for seeing, and to jam to for distraction. So I was generating a lot of frames of fake drones, just to hide the right one. So the evolution of the Atropos was the stage two. So I decided to make another drone called Interceptor that was presented here in DEF CON. And maybe I was tired to travel with a big drone along the airport. So I decided to make a tiny drone like this, just with the same system, with the same beacon system of the to transmit the commands. So the last approximation that I made with this drone was to use FM radio to send the commands to the drone, in the, just to hide. As a method to hide the communications from to the jammers. So but it was not enough for me and for us. So that was the first approximation. I have a USB trainer. It's not a drone command. It's too expensive. So I decided to put a USB router to that trainer and to connect throughout the Wi-Fi, standard Wi-Fi. That was the first approximation. The second one was to send fort beacon frames from one router to another. So and the authentication attack was not possible here. So that was the second approach, but I'm still vulnerable to jamming Wi-Fi attacks. Well, the third approximation was with the interceptor. That is it has a two-way communication. I'm able to send the commands and receive telemetry from the drone using the same system. That was the last one, to a redundant system with FM everyday payload. This is used to, for example, with the Raspberry Pi. You know, maybe you know that there's a project that did use a one pin to generate FM radio. So you are able to create your own radio station with its own name. So in the name of the radio station, travels the USB commands to the drone. So you can see the talk. Well, did several experiments with the interceptor. That was the RDS FM, and I used the RDS part, so the right one. The audio, the mono audio and the stereo audio, just was for fun. So we reached the stage three to the world weapon. So the last approach was to control the drone through the arbitrary frequency generation. So how can we do that? We generate a custom frequency, so the drone receives that frequency throughout SDR software-defined radio. So, and the last one, I able to change the frequency dynamically from the transmitter to the receiver. So, this is the current approach. I use a B-Core 2. It's a tiny board of OpenWRT. So, I use the USB at this. With the same method. So I generate through I2S bus and two ASK modulation. I'm going to explain that. So with a SDR dongle on board the drone, I can receive that command in an arbitrary frequency. So no police guns works with this. So, what is spread spectrum? Spread spectrum is a modulation that I'm able to change the frequency very fast to disturb any method to receive a jammer. So the jammer doesn't know what's the next frequency that I'm going to use. So the jammer is useless in this case.
May I use the kid's explanation?
Excuse me?
Spread spectrum is a modulation technique that broadens the signal across a frequency band much wider than the original information requires. By employing spread spectrum, resistance to noise and interference is enhanced. This is because the signal is spread over a broader spectrum and can more effectively manage noise concentrated at a particular frequency. There's two key terms inside the spread spectrum. First, the FHSS, which stands for Frequency Hopping Spread Spectrum, and second, DSSS, an acronym from Direct Sequence Spread Spectrum. We credit the remarkable innovation of the spread spectrum to Hedy Lamarr, not just a Hollywood actress, but also a brilliant inventor, in collaboration with George Amstel, that pioneered a spread spectrum system. Contrary to popular belief, while Lamarr didn't invent Wi-Fi, their work laid the groundwork for today's Wi-Fi, CDMA, and Bluetooth technology. Go ahead.
So the frequency hopping spread spectrum is the technique that we use here. So we generate the signal by toggling a general purpose input-output pin of the B-core. That is on board of the I2S bus. So if we toggle the pin very fast, we can generate a radio signal. If we solder a wire in that pin, we have an antenna. So you have a route modulation of that signal. So if you change the frequency of that toggling, you can transmit in a lot of, in an arbitrary frequency to control the drone. So this technique uses the frequency hopping spread spectrum. So I transmit a message with a given signal, with a given frequency, and the next message is transmitted with another frequency that is arbitrary. It's pre-established between the transmitter and the receiver. So this is a combination of techniques starting from have you heard about Tempest? So this is the same technique, but changing the frequency constantly. So would it be possible with a 15 bucks board instead of a Raspberry Pi, like the MT7628 chipset? Maybe. Hold my beer. So what is the I2C bus? The I2C bus is—it's not the I2S bus. Excuse me. It's not the I2C bus. The I2S bus is used to transmit and receive digital audio, but we are not using this bus for that here. So we have two wires. One wire is a clock pin, and we have a data transmission and a data receiving. We're not to use the receiving data, so we only use the clock pin for the moment. So what is the clock pin? The only one that is toggling constantly. So this is the method. Well, if we see the data sheet of the MediaTek MT7628, we see where what address we found the device, the I2S device. So we can write directly to the registers to turn on and off the clock pin. So this is the clock plan of the SOC, and we have a primary clock. We can lower the frequency of that pin by configuring the clock dividers. So by configuring the clock dividers, we are able to change the frequency constantly and seamlessly. So we have to set up our I2S device like we are with a new driver. So with this project is a new driver to the I2S device for this chipset that enables the I2C bus. But what I'm doing here is to enable and disable the clock constantly to generate high level and low level modulation. And when I want to change the frequency, so I change the last one, the dipcom config and dipint config. So we can choose a very wide set of frequencies. So if I turn on the clock, I'm transmitting in a frequency, right? Configured by the clock dividers. So if I turn on, I'm transmitting in that frequency, and if I turn off, I'm not transmitting. So the most simple modulation is to amplitude shift keying. It's the same like garage doors, remotes, and so on. But here I'm creating the modulation just turning on and down the clock of the bus. So if I want to transmit 10110, I want to turn on and off the clock and at a given frequency. So how to receive that in the drone side? We can use our SDR USB to receive that modulation. So if we tune the SDR in that frequency, we received all each packet like we see each packet like a high blue bar. So that's one command of the drone, of the transmitter transmitting to the drone. So this is the raw command seen by amplitude as the receiver that receives that packet. So we have a preamble here just to tell the receiver that this is a valid packet. So the receiver starts recording all the IQ values from SDR, and it decodes if it's in the high level or low level to decode the binary transmission. So how it works? It's an extra board aboard of the drone that accepts bit stream from a device from the file system. So it modulates 2SK and DATS and CRC8 by two timers. I have two timers here. One timer is triggered every packet, and the other one is triggered in every symbol. So we have one timer up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down on each symbol, and I have a timer up, down on each packet. So I can transmit the symbols in a very specific time and every symbol in a very specific time. So the receiver is another V-core attached to an SDR dongle that it receives in that frequency all the data from the SDR. And how I did it? By Frankenstein. Well, this is made entirely in C, no Python here, sorry. So to receive the data, I change the frequency constantly to receive the commands. So I have to use the libisdr library that is the same that use RTLS TCP and so on. So I have to make my own program. I have to program my own driver to transmit, and I have to do my own program to receive. So in this approximation, I have a list of frequencies, right? So the transmitter transmit one packet in one frequency and change to the next frequency. So the receiver have to synchronize, have to find the first packet in a given frequency. So if both sides have the list of the frequencies, the receiver knows where is in the what step in the list of the frequencies is currently. So the receiver is able to continue to change the frequency, taking account that list. So for this setup, I decide to make our own transmitter. This is a PCB board with a custom controller, so with the typical two joysticks of the drone. So using the V-core, we attach a linear amplifier to make some much more noise that is that makes the V-core itself. So this is the transmitter. So this part is the antenna attached to the I2S GPOs. That's a peak. So how we generate Well, as you see, I can transmit in a very wide range of frequencies. I make this demo in my house in Spain because, as you see, I'm transmitting with the frequency military air. So, if I go to prison, I like to go to the Spanish prison just to let my mom to bring me cigarettes. So if you see that this is the difference between the V-core without the amplifier and with the amplifier. So there is big difference, right? Each up and down is one packet, right? And as you see, I zoom out, as you see, I'm transmitting. Let's see again. Well, you see two signals here because the spread spectrum is transmitting in that frequency and this changing to a neighbor frequency. This is a demo just to demonstrate that the transmitter jumps from one frequency to another. Well, I'm able to jump in a very wide area, in a very wide range of frequencies that they're very far from each other. So, from a jammer, this is a nightmare. Indeed, we can skip the frequency hopping technique and simply transmitting with a fixed frequency, but unexpected by the jammers. So it's much more reliable and the transmitter doesn't have to jump from one frequency to another, but because it takes time for the chip, the SDR dongle is very cheap, $20, and it takes time to change the tuning frequency from one frequency to another. So we can use simply this frequency, and almost no jammer will take care about this, because what about I'm transmitting in military frequency and the jammer tries to jam my own drone, jamming indeed military frequencies, right? This is the web page of the drone. So I'm still using a Wi-Fi transmission as a primary method. So I use this modulation as a fallback. So the receiver decides which command use. If the receiver receives Wi-Fi commands, it uses them. But if the Wi-Fi doesn't work, the receiver uses the alternative method. So the last one is to demonstrate that the drone flies indeed.
Please don't kill anyone. Please don't kill anyone. So
maybe I'm not allowed to fly the drone here, sadly. I don't know what, but the drone killed very few people.
Like only three people.
As you see, it's an outside drone. It's not an inside drone. But let's make a little noise, right? Just to make noise. We come from Spain, so any of you have a code to boo? It isn't that it's too far. Well, it's jumping. But if you slow motion the video, you can see flying. Yeah. But seriously, guys, I know what I'm doing, not flying it, right? So we are fine with the time? So okay, so thank you for coming here, and if you have any questions, we will be glad to answer it. Thank you very much.